guys, my name is Henrik Reis. I hope you're doing well and I welcome you to a new video. This time from my hotel room here, and I'm currently at the Droidcon Berlin 2023. It's an Android conference, so many Android talks, but this year is also at the same time the FlutterCon in the same building. So with an Android ticket or to the Droidcon ticket, you can also attend the FlutterCon. And so there are also many Flutter talks, and as a mobile developer, Flutter is also interesting to me. So I also attended some Flutter talks, and in this video I will talk about my key takeaways from those talks I attended to, and yeah, maybe you learn something from it or get some insights about what's going on in the community right now.
The overall conference was really great and I really enjoyed it once again. It's already my fifth or fourth time I attended to this conference. This time, Hadi Hariri opened the conference with a really stunning keynote in which he talked about the history of Kotlin as well as Kotlin Multiplatform. What he mentioned also is that Kotlin Multiplatform Mobile, or KMM, to which we all referred for a long time, was kind of misleading, and now we should refer from now on to Kotlin Multiplatform KMP, which we should also know, but it's the broader framework and not only the mobile version from it anymore. But he did not only talk about the history of KMP, but he showed us also a release plan for Kotlin Multiplatform. So we can expect that JetBrains released the stable version of the framework in estimated October of this year, so 2023. Even if it's not stable yet, also he showed us many companies that already use it in production. And also from my experience, it's already usable. But of course, if it goes stable, it means that they will provide backward compatibility when they develop new versions. So I'm looking forward for that. What they also mentioned was the new Kotlin Notebook plugin, which you can just install in your IntelliJ IDE or an Android Studio IDE. It's just like the Python notebooks we already know. So if you quickly want to prototype something, it could be really handy. And the keynote really set the tone for me for the whole conference. So I tried to attend as many talks as possible regarding KMP. But of course, it was not that all talks were about this framework, but I really had the feeling that it was a big topic at this conference. Of course, Kotlin was a sponsor of this conference, so they had a big influence on that. Another talk also from one of the staff was by Ekaterina Petrova, and she is the product manager of Kotlin Multiplatform and also talked about the platform. She didn't talk about the history, but about 10 myths about this platform. Worth mentioning here is the belief that you can only start working with it when you create a new project. But that's of course not true. You can, for example, also create, she called it, micro libraries that you can extract and then, yeah, gradually migrate to the framework, or leave it only with specific parts of your app to Kotlin Multiplatform and the rest on the native part. But as always, all that glitters is not gold. The myth that KMP doesn't produce beautiful code for iOS developers is still somewhat true. For example, the framework has still no built-in functionality to produce Swift code. So the framework generates Objective-C code on the iOS side, which might not be ideal. But there are also third-party options like Mocos K Swift that you can use to generate Swift-friendly code. Which has brought some hope here at this point is that she also mentioned that the KMP team is working on a feature to generate appropriate code for Swift. So let's hope that that also comes after the official stable release. Last but not least, while this was for a long time true, she also mentioned the myth that KMP can only be used for the business logic. But that is also no longer true because they fixed the missing part and now you can also use the new framework Compose Multiplatform. In contrast to the features we have known from the framework so far, this part or framework enables us to share our UI code. So just like Flutter, you have a fully cross-functional framework at the end, which is also compatible with Jetpack Compose, which may be exciting for all you Android developers out there. So for Compose Multiplatform, there was also a talk by Sebastian Eigner. He is maybe also known from various JetBrains YouTube videos. He held a talk on Compose Multiplatform with a live demo, where he created an iOS app from an existing Android application. And I must admit, I was really astonished how well it worked. So I already worked with Kotlin Multiplatform and I liked the framework very much, but I always thought Kotlin Multiplatform is just a counterpart to, for example, Flutter or React Native. So it fills the gap and gives us an option to share our business logic while still implementing the native UI on the iOS side and the Android side. So now, if you also want to have the option to share your whole code, you can use Compose Multiplatform. Unfortunately, it's still an alpha, so maybe you have to wait a little bit, but the live demo was really exciting because we can use all the APIs we know from Jetpack Compose and at the other side also generate not only our Android app, but also an iOS app. So if you would like and decide at some time in your development process, you implemented a Compose Multiplatform app, you could just kick off the KMP part and are left with a whole fully functional Android app. So me personally, even if I use Flutter and I think it's a very good framework, I'm not such a fan of Dart, the respective programming language. So I hope that Compose Multiplatform will be successful and someday we can develop fully cross-platform apps with Kotlin. So even if this video was almost only audio, I hope you had some takeaways. Like the video, subscribe to my YouTube channel, activate the notification bell, and I hope to see you soon.